clinicaltrials.gov, there's like little hundreds of studies that are always open and enrolling. It's one place to start. As you mentioned earlier, try to get a study that's a crossover so you actually get the drug. It'd be super disappointing to like do like 10 months of something and be like, I didn't even get this drug. I don't know. But those do exist, and you can also look on the NIDA site too if you're curious. And that's open resource. You can search by compound, by condition, by anything. And ketamine clinics, which we've touched on enough to be able to keep going. Entheogenic access, similarly, there's like church protections, and some examples of that are like there's a Brazilian-based group, there's a couple of them actually, the Native American Church obviously has peyote as a sacrament as well. And you know, this is more speaking on behalf of like allyship, but anyone that is considering going into entheogenic containers, this is not informed by any research, this is my personal bias. It's like, if you do go into any of those spaces, try to really focus in on like how can you meaningfully engage with those communities, give back to those communities, and like do more than just show up for your own kind of personal well-being, and try to like leave that space somewhat harmonious in the process, because that's part of the human healing process. It's not just like, oh cool, a loophole, we can do drugs. It's like, no, like try to show up in integrity to these spaces if you do seek medicines in these kinds of spaces. Similarly, Jamaica doesn't have much on the books as far as psilocybin. There are retreats there. Beckley Foundation, which I work in partnership with to develop some of the survey research, they have a retreat down there. There's a number of others that are becoming decreasingly relevant now that there's new like US-based kind of stuff. It was kind of just people going there for the exemptions. Netherlands, you can still go and walk into a smart shop and buy truffles straight away. The first time I did go to the Netherlands and buy truffles in the shop, I was like, I can't believe the war on drugs is so loud and whatever, just for me to walk in here and just buy this. It's like such a non-event. I was like, this is not significant that I could walk in here and buy this. But that is a loophole, and some people in Europe will like kind of go over there and they'll just like spend a week and like do like light sessions with like friends or family, or they have sitter networks there as well. It could be even cheaper to like fly there and do that than it would be to go to Oregon, honestly. Same with Canada. Canada's wilding out right now. There's people like opening dispensaries selling like everything in Canada as kind of like a protest arm. This is not science at all, but there's just people like operating dispensaries. The same thing happened with cannabis. Like, we're just like civil disobedience. Like, we're just going to do this and we're going to keep doing that. They get shut down, they keep doing it, but the dispensaries up there, they'll sell just like LSD, DMT, coca, tea. Just be like, it's like there's more harm for prohibition than there is in us dispensing these materials, so we're just going to keep doing it, kind of logic. It's not an endorsement to go to those places, because again, you could get raided, they do get raided, but they exist. And then just some other examples, which again, these are all in the book, and they're also always changing. But again, for the sake of focusing in, super relevant of the moment stuff is that 109 is already in motion. There's about to start serving services with psilocybin very soon. People have like announced the pricing sheets and other stuff. It's taken a lot of effort to get the administrative stuff in order to do that. But the basic process is that those products are cultivated in accordance with state requirements, then a licensed testing facility tests those substances, then a licensed service center then administers those psilocybin doses. Interestingly, this is a non-medical model. No one actually can perform any therapy during session. If you had a license, you would lose it for doing such. So although there's a lot of news about psilocybin therapy, the Oregon model is not a therapy model. It's a facilitation model, which really only matters in the eyes of the law. But it does mean that like no one can really be a psilocybin therapist. They could be a preparation or integration therapist adjacent to a psilocybin facilitator, because that's the only people that can be present when someone consumes the medicine. Even the facilitator doesn't provide the medicine. That person actually goes to the center. They buy psilocybin from the center, and then they administer like the material they purchase themselves in observation of the facilitator. So like that's also designed for increased access. There's like a low barrier to do it. Again, there's the required preparation, administration, and integration. But even with all that, it's still quite a cumbersome process as far as like the costs and getting all that right. Like, bless Oregon for like doing this and breaking the wall. They're probably going to be subject to the fact that like they made a bunch of mistakes that other people can just avoid making. Or at least like they're going to show why doing it that way is just not going to work anywhere, period. Then we need to go further than they did. Which, again, I commend everyone the work that they're doing, and I do think they're still going to help a lot of folks, but it's going to be limited just by trying to plug a federally illegal thing into a state program is really But the requirements are really generous. All you have to be is 21 and older, have a high school diploma, be an Oregon resident for now after 25, no longer, pass a background check, and even that they gave leeway to for obvious reason for certain people that needed to be exonerated from previous instances. And that's it. Just got to get approved for licensure and pass an exam. There's criticisms up and down as far as, like, is this too little training? Is this, like, should this go further? Or is this, like, an appropriate way of, like, you know, expanding care and allowing also for, like, indigenous practitioners to not have to get a four-year therapy degree to continue legally doing what they've been doing for time millennia? So it's all kind of taken into account of all these different access needs and all the different professional offerings. And we talked about it, admittedly, I talked about it a little bit indulgently, trying to be a little bit civilly disobedient with how great things are here. But again, that the measure allows for the vegetable issuance of natural medicine service provider licenses to qualified individuals. So same way Oregon went through 2 years of planning, here in Colorado we've elected a board. That board dictates what's going to happen and what's going to be required and how it's going to all look. And as I also mentioned, the measure decriminalizes cultivation, possession, use, and sharing of a necessary amount of psilocybin, ibogaine, DMT, and mescaline. You'll see around here there's a lot of this DMT cactus and San Pedro cactus, rather. So as soon as we extract mescaline out of that cactus, we have broken the law in most places. But in the state of Colorado, we're protected to be able to do so. We could extract, there's still complicated layers of appropriation of medicines from various traditions and things of consideration, but that is a newly available thing that can be done here, the thinking is that they will then re-review this same policy and look at things like DMT centers, ibogaine centers, and mescaline centers here in the state of Colorado as of like 2026 and onward, so we might see the first like DMT therapy centers here in Colorado by then. They're using this kind of period the same way that from 2019 till now, they looked at public safety data and were like, well, we decriminalized psilocybin in Denver, we didn't get an elevation in emergency visits, didn't seem to cause any, like, there's no rise in violent crime associated, this is fine. So they're trying to gather more public safety data to validate further build-outs, while recognizing that those tools also require a whole different scaffolding. Like, ibogaine is, like, a very serious compound to work with. Like, we would not be having ibogaine Mondays and, like, giving people ibogaine to, like, figure out. Like, that's much more of, like, a cardiovascular significant drug. Yeah, so. But that's where we're at in Colorado. And there's so much other stuff, I'm not going to go down the details, but there's, like, 23 other states that have an active proposal of some sort to bring either psilocybin or at least psilocybin research, just to say it's all in motion. Now we look at the current research. This is the one I know about. This is the paper I wrote with some other people. I didn't really write the full thing. I just looked over the drafts and I helped with recruitment and language and this. But this was a survey that we conducted through University College London. They reached out to us after seeing the second book we published. They're like, oh, you seem to know a lot of autistic people that have done these things. Can we survey them? We're like, yeah, sure, we'll help. So we did a naturalistic survey. We looked at it. Naturalistic just means like people using these compounds in some setting. It could be anywhere, including like clinical context, but they're self-reporting on like their usages. It looked at the scores of the autistic question exam, the mystical experience questionnaire, and the challenging experience questionnaire. These are the MEQ and the CEQ are pretty standardly administered for a lot of just general psychedelic applications. And the autistic quotient is what I was diagnosed through and some others. Some people much prefer the ADOS. It's like a little bit more specific and has like, the AQ is kind of clunky. It has questions like, do you prefer to go to the movies or the library? Or like, do you like patterns? And like certain things that are weird that you become more disorderly if you answer one way or the other. But nonetheless, it's like we have so much data that it was like one way to anchor that data to like, is this comparable to non-autistics in terms of improvement? And the short answer is yeah. Like, the paper's in peer review now, should be out through Journal of Pharmacology by, like, August of this year. I say I can't comment specifically, but, but the short version is, like, psychedelics help people, autistic people, or people with benefits, and they're also starting from a much lower baseline, so, like, their anxiety is more significant to them when it's, like, that much drastically improved, or, like, their sociability, or a term that is referred to as a assimilation, like, a comfort within the self in social context. Is also elevated in a lot of people's like both subjective language reporting and their way they self-rated their improvement scores, which maps over our general experience in our community care. So I'm just going to do a quick time check. I'm also going to do a quick pause because that paper is kind of important. It might be relevant to you guys. But any questions about anything that we've discussed recent while we're in this like rabbit hole of like policy, et cetera, et cetera. That's good. All right, we'll keep going.
Is that paper available in any preprint or?
No, not at this time. It should be out by August. Yeah, it should be out by August, Journal of Pharmacology. And then, so from Brain Networks, this is a Compass study. Compass has their own novel synthetic, psilocybin. This one's of particular interest to me because it basically validates all the subjective reporting that we have to some level. It's not an outcome study, but they're funding a study to investigate the effects of psilocybin on the brain pathways of autistic adults. It's a double-blind, placebo-controlled study comparing the function of serotonin brain networks in autistic and non-autistic adults. And the study will look use a range of imaging techniques and behavioral tasks to determine how psilocybin impacts the serotonin system. The study's got 70 participants, 40 are autistic, 30 are non-autistic, and the study aims to improve understanding on the role of the serotonin system in autism, potentially identify new treatment options. There's also like a sort of secondary agenda to this study, which is to potentially develop subtypes of autism that have more of like an actual like neuro basis. Like something that could actually be like, that if serotonin atypicalities could create like a kind of subclass of autistics, then drugs that are serotonergic in this particular way might be especially utile for that group versus another group. So they're simultaneously looking at just like, what is this doing? And at the same point, like, is this doing different things even within the subpop of the autistic group? Like, what are the variances between the imaging and the blood work in that? And this is supposed to come out super soon. They completed it recently, so this should also be out by end of year. And this will be a massive step forward in everything. And anytime we're doing any of these kinds of studies, we're also simultaneously understanding like humans in general very well. Like we tend to almost be like the outliers that inform like the inliers, if that's a word. And so that Compass study is significant. Look for that to come soon. And that's also significant because Compass's novel compound, COMP360-something, is also the only other compound other than MDMA, which MAPS has in phase 3. It's the only other psychedelic that's in phase 3 right now. So it's likely to become legalized within 2-3 years. We might see psilocybin prescribed. And that might influence all the other stuff we just talked about as far as like the facilitator models, all this stuff. It's like right now it's a lot of stuff happening. But for the purposes of looking at other research, MyMed is also, they developed RMDMA and SMDMA. These are similar to how Johnson & Johnson developed like an enantiomer. This is like a similar form of MDMA that can be patentable. Used. They have done some early trials indicating it might be better tolerated, might reduce some of like the toxicity effects, might also be potentially something that could be used as like in a shorter amount of spacing between therapeutic sessions. So maybe you could have 3 MDMA sessions in a couple of weeks rather than months, which might have a high degree of utility. Again, a lot of these studies are oriented around like cost effectiveness of care, and they're like plumbing the depths of that. But it's just something to be mindful of, that like other forms of MDMA are also being explored. And they've specifically mentioned like ASD as a target for this particular compound because of its tolerability specifically. And these are, again, that's in process. And so also is this study, which is about to take place, it's about to undergo phase 2A. It's LSD with ADHD. I also have ADHD, as I disclosed, and like this whole, everything you see on these tables is sponsored by me doing LSD and being able to get this stuff done. It really helps me with like task initiation, flow state, and like the capacity to just like stay in one little pocket of attention for like a really long time. And it doesn't, I don't know, I'm not going to say it's better or worse than anything, but I've tried a lot of other medication for ADHD, and LSD really tremendously impacted me. Because it also, I feel like when I'm doing work, it's like, the metaphor I've drawn before is like, if I took like a 12-hour Adderall and like someone gives me like a hammer and nails, like I'll put all the nails in the wall for sure. Like I'll definitely like put like 1,000 nails in the wall on that day, but I'll never have that like spacious moment of like reflection or like kind of heart-centered thinking that I get when I also have like LSD. It has this odd combination of like serotonin and dopamine. There's a term called heterodimetization where it's like you're hitting both of those targets. You're getting kind of this like synergy benefit, and I feel like that's what I get with ADHD. They validated it in small trial already, but now they're moving to 2A where they're going to use something I mentioned earlier, MM120. But yeah, so 2A proof of concept, looking at it, it's going to have 52 patients. You're going to give them 20 micrograms of MM120, again, comparable to LSD. or a placebo, look at the outcome measures. Probably, I mean, again, a lot of these studies are kind of designed to succeed. Probably the LSD group's probably going to do better than the people taking placebo, as they might, even if they did, like, a third group that was taking some other stimulant that was dopaminergic. Like, so it's kind of set up to succeed, but just to be aware, this will be validated probably by 2024. Most people aren't really aware that there is, like, ADHD research with LSD, of all things. And an aside to that, too, is I also prefer LSD because a work day or a public school day or all these things are generally acclimated to the window that the acute drug would last with LSD. I found it challenging to kind of, like, dose in and out with psilocybin, and, like, I would kind of just be, like, rising and falling and never have that plateau. And we know that from how the drug binds. Like, it has a higher binding affinity than endogenous serotonin does. So it can stay in those receptor sites for longer and keep you in that sustained kind of effective state. But, you know, don't listen to me, listen to science eventually. And that's all I'll say. And then this one I talked about earlier, this is also Novamentis, where they're looking at Fragile X specifically. I'm by no means, am I knowledgeable that much on Fragile X, but it's a common form of inherited intellectual disability, a leading cause, theoretically, of ASD as well. Serotonergic neurotransmission is important for normal brain development, and it has been linked to both ASD and Fragile X and psilocybin. Obviously, being serotonergic in its nature, it stimulates serotonergic signaling, so it might be effective as an early intervention. This is much more experimental. This is kind of looking at, like, almost like epigenetic kind of stuff. Like, if we give psilocybin to a 6 to 10 year old, is that going to, like, alter the course of the trajectory of, like, some other form of development? Is that helpful, yes or no? Again, they have ways of figuring it out. That's why the previous study that we looked at, even though we can kind of poke holes at, like, the fact that it was a mouse model study, they do that to kind of just look at basic, like, genetic alterations and, like, blood draws and things. But that's the trajectory that one particular company is taking, is kind of, like, looking at, like, the epigenetic side of using psilocybin, which is really novel, like, really novel, and kind of considering, like, gut biome health, which is also, like, you know, there's so many competing theories about what's causing some of these dysregulations that, like, it would make sense. We have a lot of serotonin receptors in our gut, like, the most, more than the cortex. So it could be that these compounds might be valuable in that way. I'll spare you the details on it, but in this initial model, again, they found that psilocybin administered orally or specifically normalized variant, in other words, like, narrower rigid cognitive performance in the rat model. This is only in animal model studies, but Novamentis has stated intention to try to move that into human trials in time. But, like, all these things will take a while. So I want to honor the fact that we have a fourth session and we have a half hour. So I'm going to roll through this fourth lecture and then still make some spaciousness and then just kind of, like, leave an open invite. I want to be respectful to these guys in this space, but kind of just, like, an open invite. If anyone wants to, like, hang around for a short while, like, out on, like, the front patio and just kind of socialize, decompress, totally cool. I would just ask that we kind of, like, clear the space so that people that are attending to the space can kind of take care of things in here. That's kind of like a middle ground because I want to still get to the last of this on this marathon lecture that we're all in the midst of. So I'll dive into this fourth lecture and then